Great. Well, hi, everybody. Thank you for attending our second virtual seminar of this fall semester. Really excited to have an awesome panel for you guys, a really interesting discussion of the robots. And we have some great panelists for you from around the Georgia Tech campus. I think this is going to be a very interesting and eye-opening discussion. So I wanted to just thank Ellen Mazumdar, who organized this. She's going to be running most of this, but I just wanted to give the introduction. So she organized this special virtual seminar. And I also wanted to go over what our plans are for participation. So just like last time, we encourage the audience to participate. We really think you're going to have some fun things to say about these topics. It is Star Wars, so I expect lots of comments. So questions can be put up in the Q&A feature. Please use the Q&A feature. And when you upvote them, if they get enough upvotes, then I will be the one who relays the question to our panel, and then they will address your question, and hopefully in an exciting and funny way. And so with that, I'm going to head it over to Ellen Mazumdar, who's going to lead this exciting conversation. So thank you, Ellen.
All right. Thanks, Ani. Thanks for the introduction. So I have a short sort of introduction video for our panel. So it's really not a Star Wars panel if we don't have a Star Wars. Say that for us. So here's the discussion panel for today. My name is Ella Mazumdar. I'm mechanical engineering. We have joining us today Lisa Yazek. She is from literature, media, and communications. We also have Matthew Gombele. He is from interactive computing. Aaron Young is also joining us from mechanical engineering, and Ani Mazumdar will be helping us moderate for audience questions. So when we kind of put this panel together, I thought it would be fun for all of us to show some Star Wars related pictures. But when we started sending the pictures, it quickly devolved into who was more cool. And Ani decided that he wanted to join the panel just so he could show this picture of himself. One of the things that I see when we look into this panel as well is that I need to get with the times and join the dark side just like everyone else. We'll hope that everything goes well. So in today's panel, what we're going to do is we're going to cover a couple of different topics and questions. We have some pre-planned questions, but if you have questions of your own, please feel free to put them into the Q&A. We'll start off with an easy one, and we'll go sort of through everyone in the panel. So let's do, you know, a very simple question. What is your favorite Star Wars movie? And we're not going to judge anyone here, so I'll start. My favorite Star Wars movie is actually Episode 1, Phantom Menace, because it came out when I was a child, and you know there was a big influence, and there was a lot of hype about it. It has great fight scenes. So, Lisa, would you like to go next?
So it's funny, I think everyone always loves the Star Wars movie that they first saw. And I'm fortunate that I got to see Episode 4 when it was in the theaters in 77 as a very small child. And it absolutely rocked my world. I wanted Han Solo's spaceship. I wanted Luke Skywalker's lightsaber. And I certainly wanted Princess Leia's political power and her fabulous fashion. And then now I'd have to say that Episode 4 is now tied for me with the last two movies, with The Last Jedi and Rise of Skywalker, because the reality is Rey gets all those things I always wanted as a kid. And I say, go Rey.
Matthew, do you want to go next?
My favorite is Rogue One. I think, you know, spoiler alert. Okay. So at the end of the movie, the protagonist that you think succeeds, but it's like really sad because everyone's going to die. You're like, oh my gosh, that's so sad, but full of the sacrifice they made. And then all of a sudden, just this BA Darth Vader just comes and messes everyone up. It was just like, the swing and the emotion and just the raw awesomeness of that last scene of Darth Vader coming after the rebels just left me feeling like, oh my gosh, that was the most impacted I have felt from a Star Wars movie.
Thanks, Matthew. Aaron, do you want to tell us what your favorite Star Wars?
Sure. So I think my favorite is The Empire Strikes Back. I don't know. I think it's the one that resonates with me, not just because of the prosthesis, but it just has such, in my opinion, cool parts between sort of the Jedi trading and the Cloud City. Starts good, the Hoth area, but I just thought it was sort of consistently good throughout the whole movie and the most compelling.
All right, Ani, would you like to go next?
Sure. So I get to be part of this panel.
You can answer this question.
I'm gonna go with. I was gonna say Episode 4, but Lisa already took it. But I'll just do it anyway.
You can have a favorite.
Episode 4 had robots and it had dogfighting, which I'm a big aviation guy. So we had dogfighting. I'm not sure how dogfighting works in a vacuum, but it was pretty cool. And you also had Luke Skywalker arguing with his computer and doing his own thing. And you see that a lot in aviation. And so yeah, for me that was my favorite. And of course, that was the first one I saw. I saw it much later in the 90s, but still the first one. So pretty cool.
All right, thanks, everyone. If anyone in the audience has favorites too, you guys can upvote each other in the Q&A. So what I'll do is go to the next slide. So the first thing that we're going to talk about today is sort of what did science fiction look like before Star Wars, and how did Star Wars sort of impact in general? Lisa, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think one of the things that it's really hard for us to remember, especially if you weren't a full-grown adult in the 70s when you saw this movie, is that the first movie, Star Wars, this was the first time that a lot of Americans, and frankly, a lot of people around the world, were really seeing the major tropes and themes of science fiction on a big screen. And this isn't to say there wasn't science fiction before. Of course, there were science fiction movies. But they really didn't have that central part of the American imagination. And Hollywood wasn't particularly invested in doing big budget science fiction films prior to the 1970s. There are a few here and there, but not that many. Mostly you have B films. And so really, or you were watching things like Star Trek on television. The only two big science fiction movies that people really would have had access to prior to Star Wars, or at least within that 10, 15-year period, would have been 2001: A Space Odyssey and Barbarella. And those are both awesome movies. And if you've never seen them, you must see them both. But the reality is, neither of them are really represent the sort of main and central ideas of science fiction. 2001 is very avant-garde, very abstract, very much part of new wave cinema making and new wave science fiction. It's very quiet and a very weird movie, very alienating in some way. Barbarella is the exact opposite. It's very human, very saucy. You know, it's basically a soft porn movie. And it's very much about human sexuality, and space just happens to be the kind of cool backdrop. So one of the things that I'm always find really striking when I talk with science fiction creators who saw the Star Wars movies in the 1970s is that this is the first time they were seeing the things that they had helped create, the concept of hyperspace, the idea of artificial satellites, even the idea of cyborgs and androids up on the big screen in a way that really was true to the history of science fiction. And that's something I feel was really exciting for people. And it was also exciting for people because even if you weren't into science fiction, there were other ways you could get into it. Joseph Campbell's Hero of a Thousand Faces was a huge, huge influence for George Lucas when he was doing this. And this is a time when people were really starting to rethink mythology and wondering how, as modern men and women, we might fit into historic cycles of myth. And Star Wars really seemed to show us a way that we could plug ourselves into these stories that happened both long ago and in the world of tomorrow, both here on Earth and in places far away.
Lisa,
Oh, you want me to talk? I'm sorry.
would you like me to show the video, or do you want to go to the next slide?
What we can go on and show the video. That would be great.
Okay, let me see if I can get that.
Star Wars follows the outline of the monomyth, which consists of stages like the call to adventure, supernatural aid, the belly of the whale, the road of trials, the meeting with the goddess, and a bunch more. Also huge influences were the Flash Gordon serials from the 30s and Japanese director Akira Kurosawa. Star Wars plays much like an updated version of Flash Gordon, right down to the soft wipes and the opening titles design. From Kurosawa, we get masters of spiritual martial arts, a low-ranking bickering duo, more soft wipes, a beneath-the-floorboards hideaway, and a boastful baddie getting his arm chopped off.
You just watch yourself. We're wanted men. I have the death sentence on 12 systems.
War films and westerns were also huge sources for Star Wars. The scene where Luke discovers his slaughtered family resembles this scene from The Searchers. And the scene where Han Solo shoots Greedo resembles this scene from The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. The climactic airstrikes in the Dam Busters, 633 Squadron, and the bridges at Toko Ri play very similarly to the run in the Death Star. And in many cases, existing shots were even used as templates for Star Wars special effects.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, that's such a great clip. And I think one of the things that's really key here and that it underscores the point I'm making is that given that many viewers didn't really know yet how to watch science fiction in the way that we're all very familiar now, it makes sense that Lucas was going to draw on so many other kinds of films that people would have had familiarity with. That's one of the ways you build consensus for that kind of world. So in addition, right, so he's drawing on Kurosawa's films, he's drawing on Flash Gordon, and he's also drawing on one of the oldest science fiction film out there, and that's Metropolis. So the oldest full-length science fiction film, rather, right? So this is from 1927, and what you see is two of the main tropes in science fiction come from Metropolis, and Lucas really picks them up and runs with them in Star Wars. So the first thing you have, of course, is the Fist of Doom, right? And that Fist of Doom, it always signals that mad scientist, the mad engineer, someone who somehow has gone wrong and lost sight of the fact that they're supposed to be working for the good of society. And that sort of loss of connection to humanity is signaled by the loss of a hand, right? And it's interesting. So you can see that with Rotwang he's the evil scientist in Metropolis, up in the corner. And then it's no mistake that you often see Darth Vader in a very, very similar pose. I think one thing that's interesting is by the time we see Luke giving us the Fist of Doom, he's actually taken the glove off and showing us the bones, what's underneath the Fist of Doom. And I think that's important because at that point, Luke himself is distinguishing himself from that line of mad scientists and mad engineers, right? The other thing you get is an interesting rewriting of Metropolis. Metropolis was the first film to give us the modern iconography for the wayward robot or the rampaging robot, right? And that robot here is that she's called the evil Maria sometimes. She's supposed to be a doppelganger to a good character in the film who's named Maria. What's interesting, of course, is the evil Maria is all metallic and sexy and beautiful and dangerous. What she becomes, of course, in Star Wars is the exact opposite. She becomes, first of all, C-3PO, male, gold, not very sexy, and extremely polite and helpful. So rather than being the rampaging robot that threatens to disrupt our sexual and economic and political and technological economies, C-3PO, right, becomes the helpful robot, the friendly robot who helps us keep order and maintain connection in the universe. So thanks, Ellen. Right. Yeah. So that helps people. Right. So if that gave people another frame through which to understand Star Wars, and of course, it was the way that Lucas was inspired. Lucas has talked himself about the fact that the 1972 film Silent Running was also a major inspiration, especially for his droid design. So if you've never seen this, it's a marvelous little eco-criticism film. Really, really beautiful. And the droids in it, Huey, Dewey, and Louie, are utterly charming. In many ways, they do indeed look, as you can see, like R2-D2. And one of them even has the kind of extender hand that R2-D2 has that can come out of him and open locks and do other kinds of things. So again, it's interesting that Lucas is drawing on a wide array of sources out of different cultures, but also out of different times. So he's going all the way back to the beginning of science fiction history, and then going right into the present and working with some of the most interesting and critically acclaimed, if sort of small, films that were coming out around that time.
Lisa,
make people believe
we have
in
some
droids.
Questions. Actually, yeah. Hold on. So we have some questions, and I see that the next slide maybe segues into that. Do we want to show the slide about how this technology portrayed, and then I can read you some of the questions?
Just really quickly, before we transition to the slide, I don't have the audio on here, but the way that the person interacts with the robots is very similar to how they talk to R2-D2. R2-D2 doesn't speak. And so the person also has the same kind of interaction with these robots. They don't speak. So I think it's also kind of very interesting there. And the one on the bottom. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's more like a human pet relationship in some ways than a sentient being to sentient being thing at first.
Yeah, he's very, obviously in this clip, he's very frustrated with his robots. Yeah. Okay, so let me go to the next slide. So in terms of kind of the history of Star Wars and how that kind of has, you know, looking at what other people have thought of technology, how they brought it into their movies, this is sort of how did Star Wars sort of bring technology into the Star Wars movies. So, and how was it portrayed and how give on the good or bad of technology. Ani, do you want to ask your question really quickly?
Yeah, so there's a number of questions. I think Pooja really helped us get the conversation started. And essentially the question is, so Pooja asks, do you think all science fiction, or do you all think that science fiction is a result of current technical direction or it helps steer it? And I think other people are asking similar things. So we have Insung talking about what are examples of technology that stemmed from science fiction. And then we have, I think Jordan had a similar question. So I'll start with maybe a quick answer to maybe a broader question about science fiction, not about Star Wars, and maybe that can lead into you guys, is that it's in fact been shown, I read this in a book and I found it really fascinating, is that when asked to predict the future, science fiction writers did a far better job of predicting the future in terms of at least warfare than politicians, soldiers, scientists, and that was to me really remarkable, because the people who you thought would be the experts, right, the guys who are building stuff, the guys who fight wars, the guys who are in charge of governments, actually were much worse at predicting the future than someone like H.G. Wells, who in War of the Worlds actually predicted a lot of the things that would happen during the World Wars. And so I think in general, science fiction has had a very predictive power in our world, and maybe you guys can talk about it more related to Star Wars.
If I can jump in.
Go ahead.
If Matt's got something, he should go ahead. I can round out later.
Yeah, anybody feel free to...
Go for it, Matt. Yeah. Go for it, Matthew.
All right. Yes. So I hate to say this, but it goes both ways. So I'd like to give you a nice answer, but look, let's look for an example for inspiration. I think a lot of people were inspired by, for example, Star Trek. Some of the devices, like the tricorder, I have a friend who's doing a startup for a medical tricorder. They wanted me to be a subject, but my wife wouldn't. That was sad. And on the flip side, I think tricorders, people are trying to invent that. I think cell phones and a lot of handheld devices coming from things like, your communicators, certainly robotic hands, some of the inspiration, maybe Aaron can talk to that. But the flip side is that, for example, in The Mandalorian, the clip that I wanted to show you all, but I couldn't despite my best efforts to record it, thanks Disney Plus, is actually there's a scene where an alien is trying to retrain a droid that was designed for killing people really effectively, IG-11. It was a bounty hunter droid. So he reprogrammed it using what I'd call a form of somewhere between reinforcement learning and inverse reinforcement learning. The guy actually talks about giving it affirmation and praise and nurturing the robot. It's absolutely fascinating. And I think it gets a lot of what we've been looking at in, for decades in reinforcement learning about how do you teach a robot from scratch after you reset it to do some other task rather than having to program it with like Python or C++ or whatever it is they're doing on Star Wars. So I think a lot of ideas also start feeding into to science fiction as well about like what is possible. And I think to get at the point about the politicians and people in the military, I mean, first of all, politicians just aren't trained for that ever. Like, that's just not what they're good at. They're good at it. Like, they're supposed to be lawyers interpreting law. At least that's what most of them are. I think science fiction writers are unique because they specifically go to talk to all the scientists as part of their job to figure out what is possible. And then by talking and gaining consensus and looking at history and trends, they can kind of get a sense of like, what is the likely next 10 or 20 or 30 years? And so I think they offer a very valuable insight into where we're going to go. So I think there's certainly a feedback loop.
Can I jump in?
Yeah.
Please.
Okay, so I think on the certainly on the prosthetics or exoskeleton front, this is played out in almost like a very direct way, in that science fiction has, you know, come out with these cool things, the Lucan being a good example, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But another great example is the Iron Man project, which, you know, is also referred to as kind of the Talos project by the U.S. Army. And essentially, there have been these major, not sort of just, oh, let's build some cool technology, but huge funding initiatives that are based around a sci-fi technology that the Army or DARPA wants to see made. And the Luke arm is a great example of that. That was, I would actually say, fairly successful. Talos was sort of an almost impossible project that I think, you know, has largely been regarded as kind of a failure. But, you know, I do think that there's some major that our politicians our funding agencies are actually looking at sci-fi for inspiration on some of the major sort of out there initiatives that have gone out. So there is huge inspiration from sci-fi that has gone into actual money being distributed to labs and to companies.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, Aaron. And I think we'd be remiss, especially those of us who are born in the 80s, to bring up that during the Reagan administration, they started a missile defense program that was literally called Star Wars. Right. So I don't get more direct line from movie to government initiative than that.
Yeah, I would agree with both of you guys. I think also part of it is a chicken and egg thing. So if, you know, we can capture the public imagination by, you know, using a movie which has, you know, millions of audience members. And then, you know, when you try to build a program in the government and you can say you have something, a frame of reference for everyone to follow, right, then it becomes sort of an initiative and people can say, oh, yeah, that was really cool. I think we should do something. It's a little bit harder easier to build a public sentiment based on something everybody has experienced.
If you guys don't mind me jumping in real quick as an 80s baby. So I totally don't even remember who Reagan was. I know nothing about him from my personal experience other than what I read online and see in clips. But just as a fact check, Reagan was not behind why it was called Star Wars. It was actually called Star Wars by his critics because they thought it was stupid and grandiose. So it was actually an insult.
Yes, I knew that. I wasn't expecting to be fact checked by my own panel. It's actually called the Defense Initiative. But thank you, Matthew.
Yes, actually, of course.
There's actually a more complex story behind it, even than that you may or may not know.
Oh, then go for it. Go for it.
Yeah, actually. So what happened was actually since the 1960s, there have been groups of scientists and science fiction authors who have served as advisors, both formally and informally, to the United States government. And there was a group in the 60s and 70s, I think if I'm remembering correctly, I'd have to double check it. I think it's called the Citizens Advisory Group. And it had a number of U.S. generals in it, and then a number of science fiction authors, including Jerry Purnell and Larry Niven. And they were the ones who were sort of joking around about the Star Wars thing. And there's a sense that perhaps that particular group is what who fed that nickname out to the public. Although to this day, both Purnell and Niven swear that it was not their fault. But I think it's interesting to know that you had this group of people who were thinking through science fiction scenarios with the government. And then suddenly the name Star Wars is out there going from movies out into the public. So that's kind of interesting. If I something else I wanted to bring up really quickly, someone had asked if and when science fiction precedes or shapes science. And you know, most science fiction artists would tell you what we do in our community is not prophecy, it's extrapolation. So it's exactly like what Matthew was getting at. It's the idea that artists look around at the current state of science and society and ask, what if? And then do these hypothetical scenarios, right? And push that forward. You might think about science fiction as a kind of thought experiment, for instance, right? So often, while it looks like science fiction is anticipating or predicting the future, it's only because you've had someone who's very smart and very carefully looking through what's going on with science at the time and then asking those what if questions and evolving it. So, and there are examples of this I can give that are outside of robotics. But one thing that I think that's really great, a great one, is the word robot itself, for instance, right? If Star Wars is all about robots and got people really excited about robots and droids, the word robot itself comes from science fiction. It's from a 1920 play by Karl Capek called R.U.R., Rossum's Universal Robots. And robot is the Czech word for indentured laborer or slave laborer. So you can see, and that's right, it's exactly right. That's what robots do. They do the kind of horrible work that we as humans don't want to do, right? And then it makes sense why our robots are always rampaging, because they don't want to be slaves anymore. They want to be free. And it's interesting, right? Because you begin to see that in the later Star Wars movies as the robots realize, hey, yeah, maybe we have a stake in this future as well. So I'm really with you guys in that idea that there's this feedback loop between science and art here. And so I think it's important. We don't want to think about science fiction as prophesying things. It's really extrapolating. For instance, those of you who want to learn more about it, there's a great website called technology.com. I can put it in the Q&A if you'd like. And it's a website that's put together by people who map out where are the first artistic ideas, where do we see the first representations of different scientific concepts in art and vice versa. And that's really instructive to see who gets to where first.
Yeah, thank you, Lisa. If you can put that into, yeah. I guess, the chat, we can take a look at that as well. Do you want me to play the two videos associated with this slide?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
All right.
Look at him, he's heading for that small moon.
I think I can get him before he gets there. He's almost in range.
That's no moon. It's a space station.
It's too big to be a space station.
Very bad feeling about this.
So one of the reasons I wanted to show those clips, because they wanted to talk over me, obviously, was really just, I think one of the things that's really important, and I think it's important to think about actually as people who are thinking science and technology, is that science fiction art doesn't just show us possible futures, it tells us how we're supposed to feel about those futures. And in fact, we talk about this as one of the great beauties of science fiction, that it has these different emotional poles, and that it encourages or invites readers to go to those different poles. And the two different clips I showed you show you the two different emotional poles of science fiction. So that first clip with the revelation of the Death Star, right, that's showing us the technological sublime. And if you're not familiar with the concept of the sublime, this is an idea that goes all the way back to the Romantics, and that the sublime is the experience we have when we see, encounter things that dwarf the human mind. And originally that meant things like infinity or hurricanes or huge mountains. But as we've become increasingly techno-scientific people, we now talk about the technological sublime. And as modern humans, we're awed and terrified by the things we make. Huge dams, skyscrapers, bridges, railroads, and of course, Death Stars, right? And we're both awed and terrified by the things we can do here. And you'll notice that science fiction teaches us how to feel about the sublime through a couple special effects, right? You always get the zoom out like you do here, where at first you're like, what am I looking at? And then it zooms out and you're like, oh my God, it's huge and it's big and it's scary and it's mind blowing, right? You'll notice the dialogue dwindles when you see the sublime, the music swells, and you as an audience are told, your mind is blown, right? So you're supposed to note that. The other thing, of course, is the other pull we have in science fiction is the technological grotesque. And that's really what you see with the second clip, right? And the grotesque is obviously just the exact opposite sensation of the sublime. The grotesque suggests to us that there's either there are things that defy science and rationality, or that we are using, perverting even science and rationality towards disgusting and disruptive and horrifying ends. And you'll notice that while the sublime is always about massive scale things, massive scale engineering things, massive spaces, et cetera, the grotesque becomes, it goes inward instead. And you see that in this clip, that you start pulled back, but you dive inward, and it goes inward to the personal and to the body. And those bodies are always disgusting. And that's how you know it's grotesque, because it makes you feel queasy, right? There are bodies that have been ripped open. They've had things shoved into them that don't belong. They're leaky. They're mashed up with other kinds of bodies. They're strange. They're not cool. And we're just terrified and disgusted. There's no awe in the situation at all. And I think Star Wars really helps translate those two modes to the big screen. And today we see these all the time. I mean, just go watch any MCU movie, and now you too can play the grotesque and sublime game.
Yeah, I think Star Wars does a really good job of doing both of those things. And it sort of kind of segues into the next topic.
Do you mind if I jump in real quick? Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
So this is all like really awesome. I'm really glad to be on this panel and learn, Lisa. This is great. I think we want to regularize somewhat of our talk about technology and sci-fi in stories like Star Wars. Let's ignore 7 through 9 and everything Disney did. Let's just think for a moment about 1 through 6. Like, it was a story. It was an archetypal story between good and evil, very clear contrast, the rise and fall of Anakin Skywalker. And I think that the setting in the sci-fi universe is a mode through which we are...
Okay, so while we are trying to get Matthew back, this is sort of like the segue from the previous slide in terms of the types of technology and what kind of feeling it gives you. You know, Star Wars has a ton of different kinds of droids, and they have obviously cyborgs and humans, and it's sort of on a continuum in some ways. You have, you know, people who are normal humans. You have people with and different levels of prosthetics. So you have, you know, Luke with just a hand, Darth Vader with most of his body, and General Grievous with even more of his body that's robotic. And then you have robots that think like people and talk like people, and they're funny. You have robots that, you know, aren't shaped like people, but are also, you know, adorable. And you have robots that do services. So there's quite a spectrum. And I think Star Wars is sort of fair in terms of how they, you know, say some robots are good and some robots are evil. And they're sort of, in general, Star Wars gives a very neutral view of this type of technology.
Is Matthew back?
Yes, I'm back. Sorry about that.
Do you want to finish your thought?
Yeah, you probably should just restart. Good versus evil.
My point, yes, good versus evil, that I think it's ultimately about the rise and fall of Anakin in 1 through 6. And so I think the technology is kind of along for the ride, or helping to suspend our disbelief and create this fictional world, this sandbox in which we can view these archetypal roles of good and evil, the fall of one man, and then the redemption of him through his son. And I think the technology becomes a sideshow in some ways. Because, you know, we can't explore things like, are robots going to take over our jobs? Or are robots going to kill us all? And kind of the normal tropes of Terminator and robots, or even sexuality and relationships with robots that we saw, for example, more in Solo. And to that extent. So it's interesting how the robots aren't the focus, in my opinion, about telling of the story. I just wanted to add that as a regularization to our machine learning algorithm inferring kind of things here.
Yeah, Aaron, do you have any thoughts on that? I'm pulling up your slides now.
Why don't you go ahead and show the video first?
I'll play it without sound. Because I think it's just music.
Okay, so I think a lot of people are kind of familiar with this scene, but this is where Luke gets refitted with his hand prosthesis after getting it chopped off in a lightsaber duel with his father. For those who don't know, that's Darth Vader. And I think what's really cool is this is inspired a lot in prosthetic technology, and a lot of groups have tried to kind of get to or emulate this device. I'll briefly kind of go through what is available today and what has been inspired. So as we mentioned previously, the DARPA project really tried to revolutionize prosthetics, and it was based kind of around this framework of creating the Luke arm. And I would say, and we're going to break this down from three different technologies that you kind of saw in that movie, the first being the mechanical systems and then controls and then more on the sensing part. And I think maybe I'm biased, I'm a mechanical engineer, but the mechanical systems, I think we've done a really good job. The field is very close to what Luke had from a mechanical standpoint. We have hands out there, iLimb and B-Bionic being great examples of commercially available systems, fully articulated, really low form factor, every finger can be controlled independently, and at really low weight. And just for people to wrap their heads around this, usually an actual prosthesis has to be about half the mass of our actual limbs to make it a usable device. And that's just because it's kind of this onboard extension. Now that, one of the cool technologies that we've come out with recently is known as osseointegration, where we drill into somebody's bone and attach the prosthesis directly. And that really allows for a much more physical connection of these devices to the human user. And that becoming more and more common in prosthetic technology today. And these mechanical hands are ultra advanced, really capable of doing a lot. The problem is, we really don't have, from a control system engineering, the ability to control all these different degrees of freedom that some of these hands may have, that may be up to even like 15 degrees of freedom. And the issue here is, where do you get the control signal from? And the most popular technology, hands down, is myoelectric. So that's EMG control, where basically people use their residual muscles to control the device. And what is now commonly used in the field, sort of the most advanced technology in prostheses, is what's known as pattern recognition or machine learning techniques, where we just take basically these patterns in EMG and we can relate them to different motions. And this is pretty common. It's now that it was in sort of research at the start of the century, and nowadays is clinically available, and you can kind of see this. But what this is kind of constrained to is primarily patterns in which we sort of just control a single grip of the hand. Yeah. So we really don't have, at least clinically available, any way of doing sort of direct finger control that's seamless, intuitive, and natural. And so usually these are set up like this, where somebody can kind of think about doing grips and it can form as a good tool. And so this is definitely useful. It's cool. It's really advanced over the last 5 to 10 years, but what we don't have is kind of simultaneous control of multiple degrees of freedom, which our normal hands might do, or the ability to fully control digits with just surface EMG. And so what now is sort of in the research frontier, and maybe the ability to do this is using intramuscular EMG, where the IMEs is a great example of this, where you might take a shot, we put a little tiny sensor that's wireless in your muscles, and now we can get sort of direct finger control once we can get to those lower muscles. Another common technology now, Case Western's doing a lot of this, are nerve cuff designs, where you attach directly down to the nerve, you measure the EMG, or the nerve signal, so the actual action potential is coming down, and you can get some pretty cool control options with a prosthesis with these things. But of course, all of this is very invasive. The part that you saw where Luke was sort of clearly sensing and feeling pain is where we're probably furthest away from the Star Wars technology. And so that's really the idea of sensing or even proprioception, which is the ability to feel kind of where your hand is. And that is really the last link that's needed in order to have sort of natural or intuitive control of a prosthesis, where it really sort of becomes a part of yourself or that you feel embodied with that device. And we are working on this. The nerve cuffs, I think, are maybe the closest, where we might stim some of those sensory nerves and try to map out. Basically, you know, we can provide sensors on the device that can tell maybe that you're in contact with something, but actually coming up with a way of mapping that to the correct brain inputs or the nerve inputs that go to the brain is really challenging. Usually it kind of feels like, oh, something is pulsating weird on my palm. That's the type of thing that you get. And the problem really is understanding how the brain encodes all these sensory inputs and being able to come up with the right simulation paradigms to actually get the sensation, something that we're definitely not sort of close to at this period. So I would say, you know, in mechanical, we're big shot control, we're getting closer, but maybe not quite there. And this sensation and proprioception, we're still a long ways out compared to the loop technology. Okay.
Aaron, do you want me to play the video?
Oh, it's on your screen. Okay. Oh. I thought it was on my screen, sorry. I'd already advanced. Yeah, you can play the video. I mean, it just...
It won't play audio, but it's not a big deal.
Yeah, so this is just showing what I talked about a little while ago, which was the sort of the ability to control individual grips is really where we're at on the control side. Okay.
This was the last thing you were talking about in terms of connection to nerves.
Yeah.
Do you guys have any other thoughts about how Star Wars has had an effect on prosthetics or cybernetics?
No, sorry. I did want to bring up like an interesting, I think, paradox for me, and perhaps that paints a grim picture of the future for people in the fields of biology and chemistry and health. And that it's very interesting that we can clone, like the Kaminoans can clone an entire army and raise them very quickly, program them, but we can't regrow an arm. Like, I think that is something that's very interesting. And I think in some ways, that's not purposefully trying to say that, like, we're not going to advance in healthcare. What I think that's though saying is more like a perspective that the integration of man and machine dehumanizes you, very much what you saw at the end of episode 3, and that Darth Vader losing the arm, he became less human, he became corrupted by evil. And I think it's very interesting with Luke, it's not necessarily that he was corrupted by evil, although he is tempted in episode 6. I think the fact that Luke loses his hand gets at the fact it's something like kind of the myth of Horus having to send and go and fight the evil of Seth and losing his eye and becoming injured through your confrontation with evil. And in a Jungian sense, like Carl Jung, that really is the descent into the underworld of confronting, like your own self is the evil, like you see in the cave on Dagobah, right? With Yoda, that Darth Vader is himself. And through that confrontation with the evil within himself, he becomes wounded permanently. And that carries with him for the rest of his time. And we see that in episode 7, 8, 9. So I think that the prosthetic is really a device to describe the wounding, the permanent wounding of you through the confrontation with evil. Whereas I might imagine in a future, hopefully we can just regrow your limbs. But in the meantime, if I ever lose my arm, I'm definitely calling Aaron, you, after I call 911 to help get that prosthetic ready and set up for me. Because that's really cool stuff.
I think that segues to your next slide, Ellen.
Oh, actually, it's a sort of a combo of two slides. Let's see if I can actually get to share. So it's sort of a, you know, that was a really good topic to talk about, Matthew. But basically, you know, we're looking at how does technology get portrayed in Star Wars, and how some technologies are super advanced and some are not. So there's two questions associated with that. One is, how do the characters think about AI and machine enhancements? And the second question that's sort of related is, what does Star Wars get right about artificial? What does it think about things like love and other characteristics? Now, I didn't actually intend to do this originally, but it seems that there is a slightly different perspective between the original movies that Lucas made and sort of the newer ones. The newer ones seem to have a lot more robots that sacrifice themselves for humans. And the original movies seem to have a slightly, you know, different perspective, although it may be maybe selective memory on my part. But if you guys have any other examples, that would be good. So I'll quickly show you the videos associated with that. First one.
Use the Force, Luke. Let go.
The Force is strong, isn't it?
Luke, trust me.
So that first one was Luke being told not to use the Force, or to use the Force and not to use his machine hand. The second one, I think, is probably very familiar. The second one is Obi-Wan saying that machines are, well, at least Darth Vader is not a good person because he's part machine.
Those analysis droids only focus on symbols. I should think that you Jedi would have more respect for the difference between knowledge and wisdom.
Well, if droids could think, there'd be none of us here, would there?
He's more machine now than man. Twisted and evil.
So, you guys want to talk a little bit about sort of Star Wars' perception on sort of good and evil and AI and machines and how they kind of work with humans?
Well, it seems to me, right, like Star Wars, especially the earlier movies, they work, because they're using that Campbellian structure, they're really working through very basic binaries that structure our thinking in the West, right? Good and evil, black and white, and then, of course, human versus machine, right? And you see this, that humans are supposed to have control over their machines and be distinct from them, right? And as humans sort of become more politically corrupt or other kinds of corrupt, I think it's exactly like Matthew was saying, that they become infested with machines or more closely interwoven with machines, right? And it suggests this sort of loss of control over the self, over the body politic, right? And of course, the universe itself eventually. Whether or not the current movies do that, it seems to me like the current droids are more sentient and more treated like people, right? Rather than tools. And this is no surprise in three movies that have been frankly criticized by a number of people for being too diverse. And it's such as no surprise that once we start thinking about diversity, we're going to include not just all kinds of humans, but all kinds of non-humans who are also people. So.
Yeah, interesting point. I figure I'll just jumping on that point, I do agree. I think there's a divorce between 1 through 6 and then 7 through 9 in terms of robots previously being inferior. Like, even though they can be scary, like the droids that like roll like little scorpion things and then shoot, like the Jedi are even scared of them, right? But ultimately, they can all just be flipped off with a switch. They can't think for themselves. And even the droid armies in episode 1 are just flipped off as soon as, like, nobody is going to design a fully centralized robot army if that ever happens. Like, that's, yeah, flip a switch and turn it on or off, right? So I think that they're portrayed as puppets as inferior. In the later movies, I do think you're getting into a much more almost Eastern view of, you know, in terms of animism and anthropomorphization of these entities to develop relationships with them. And I think again, I think that's probably a more realistic picture, because I think we already have things like robotic seals that are given to people in elder care facilities to develop relations with them, because they don't have access to, you know, touch it to their loved ones as much. They're isolated, and giving them simple even robots that seem kind of anthropomorphic can actually improve your spirits, and that in turn can improve healthcare, improve outcomes. So I think we are very much likely going in a direction more like 7 through 9 in terms of having what humans think are real and meaningful relationship with robots. I don't think robots are going to think that they have real and meaningful relationships with people necessarily, unless we program them to think that way. But I do think that the human imagination is susceptible to this imprint in developing the relationships with many things, just as a child develops relationship with a stuffed animal. And I think it's interesting that in The Mandalorian in particular, gets it really cool in terms of like, what is it actually like to program these robots? That I think that puts this idea that the robots are not good or evil. They are what you program to be, what you teach them to be, do you give them affirmation or not. I think that's a very human perspective on these devices. And I think the last point that this love thing, this like, it's interesting, this pansexual relationship that people have described potentially between Lando Calrissian and the droid and his and the Millennium Falcon, I forget the droid's name. I think so much of that was left to the interpretation of the audience that, and I think that's what good art does. So I think there's somewhat of a debate between the audience members. I'd love to talk to the writer and like, was those hints of potentially more than just a friend or platonic relationship between Lando and the robot, was that like done on purpose? Were those overtones done purposefully? And I do think that we see that in present society with sex robots and other things that we're getting at. And I think there's a lot of ethical questions that we have to wrestle with as a society, and what is that even going to look like? And I think sci-fi can be a helpful way to start exploring those things and decide as a culture, like what is appropriate and inappropriate. But I sometimes get a little standoffish when people read way stuff into it, when it's not like textually there, like literally you can touch it and see it. And so I don't know how much is read into these scenes versus what they're meant to be.
I think they're very open texts. This is a concept that comes out of cultural studies, that in order for a text to be popular, like a commercially produced text, it has to be open. And that means open to interpretation, right? And Star Wars, I mean, that's part of its massive success, is you can read whatever the heck you want into these, right? It doesn't matter what your political affiliation. Every single person thinks they're the rebellion and that the political party they dislike is the empire, right? And I think it's the same thing with the sexuality of the droids. You read into it what you want to see there and what your own hopes and fears are for the future.
Yeah, that's really cool. And the idea of the self-sacrifice in the robots, it is, I think, something that captures us in our minds as being like, oh my gosh, you sacrifice yourself, this, you know, messianic or other kind of laying your life down for another. It's very interesting to think in how we have robots today that like for robot, that's just an equation. But for us, when we see it, we think, oh my gosh, they're actually sacrificing something. They have a life, they're mortal. And I think that is something that is explored really with C-3PO. C-3PO's mortality in episode 9, having to be able to speak a Sith language. And I think that's also something that we're wrestling with and portrayed, you know, kind of in an interesting way in some of the later episodes.
I think that's a really good point about the mortality. I'm reminded of the book by Peter Singer. I can't remember the name of it now, but it was about robots, Wired for War. And he talks about the iRobot robots that were used in Iraq to dispose of bombs. And they would sometimes get blown up, as was their job. And the soldiers would actually bring back individual parts of the robot to the depot and say, can you put it back together? And iRobot or whatever contractor would be like, no, we'll just give you a new one. And the soldier would be like, no, I want you to put back this robot because it was part of our team. And I think that's a really interesting effect that maybe is portrayed in these movies, that otherwise people wouldn't have even anticipated, that people would want to put together a set of motors and gears or whatever, and they really believe it's part of their team and they have kinship with it.
You know, we see that in Interstellar. Have any of you seen Interstellar, right? Because you've got those amazing robots, Kase and Tars, which I think are the two coolest robots in contemporary film. And when you're watching the movie, it's really easy to start thinking about them as part of the team. And then there's a point where they have to go and kill other robots and they just do it without thinking. And you're like, what? Because you're so used to thinking them as being human and part of that team. So that's interesting that you even see That I had no idea that about that that was happening with soldiers, but that you see a very sort of similar dynamic now happening in film. So once again, that sort of tight weaving in of art and reality, I guess.
And it's kind of concerning from like the perspective of my field in human robot interaction is that like we conduct studies in our lab and I know how to get you to think that my robot is more human or more alive or less alive to make you trust it more or less. And so we, in terms of the design, the physical design of the robot and also the design of the algorithms, we have so much control and power to manipulate you and to get you to interact with our device how we want. And so I think, you know, that's kind of, you know, isn't necessarily portrayed in Star Wars, but I think it makes me think we have to be super careful with how we manipulate people, especially like vulnerable populations, whether it's people who are children or elder care, people who have mental handicaps and others. And, you know, that does bring about some really important issues.
So that's interesting.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Lisa. I was just going to say we're only out of time, so I wanted to make sure Ellen had time to.
This is actually our last question. So everything asked after this is sort of summary slides. So do you guys want, we can talk over the slide if you want, but this is basically saying, you know, what technologies have Star Wars properly predicted and, you know, what technologies have they should have predicted. Obvious things that have worked, video conferencing, and we don't have holograms, we have video conferencing. Heads up displays, we have robots in every home now, and they did not when they first did Star Wars. So, I mean, some of the other things that they've predicted, we've never had. So if you guys want to, you know, continue the discussion over the slide, we can certainly do that. This is sort of the last content slide that I have.
We have toy lightsabers, right? If nothing else. I mean, I think I got a light, I guess I saw the original Star, I mean, we've always had those too. I saw the original Star Wars in 77, and by that Christmas, my sister and I had lightsabers in our hands. So. And now I have fancier ones that light up like the ones on TV. So we sort of have them, maybe, in a way. I don't know what we'd really use a lightsaber for, though.
Yeah. Like Matt had mentioned earlier, there's some, like, you know, why can't they regrow your arm? Or Lisa, we were talking about this earlier, like, why can't they save Padme, right? So it's sort of like some technologies that we probably have now, they didn't incorporate into Star Wars.
Right. Unless you think that Palpatine used the Force to kill her.
That's awesome. Now controversial. Don't say things you can't take back.
Well, I think the film, don't you think the film kind of, it implies she died of a broken heart, which also implies then that they had no sense of postpartum depression or any kind of like sort of therapeutic or, you know, system set up to deal with the trauma of.
They didn't even try.
War. I know.
There's like she's, said, we're losing her. She's,
yeah, like I said,
you know,
lousy maternal services there, I gotta say.
I also wonder how women will feel about robots catching their babies, because I have literally been in the news saying that I'm developing robots that are going to deliver babies, yank babies out of women. Totally not true. It's a lie. But that's what you get for being in the media. But it is interesting that, you know, for some reason, that seems to totally be okay, that we're going to have robots, you know, pulling babies out of women. Yeah, that's kind of weird.
Well, I'd say there's a several hundred year tradition of women imagining alternatives to physical childbirth, which, of course, we should all remember was extremely dangerous until very recently. So whether or not I want something yanking things out of me, that sounds a little bit like the science fictional grotesque, but, you know. Glass wombs, things like that, that's often been a fantasy for women, you know? I mean, again, taking away the dangerous and hard part of, in this case, biological and reproductive labor rather than productive labor, but sure.
Also, where was her epidural?
Yeah, where was anything for that poor woman, right? I mean, my goodness. Oh.
Yeah, so does anybody have any closing comments? I'll go ahead and say thank you to everyone on the panel and everyone who helped out, especially the people at IREM who have helped us put together this broadcast Blue Jeans. I'd also like to thank each of our panelists, Lisa, Matthew, Aaron, and Ani for helping out. And of course, as an engineer, you know, whether you're a droid type of engineer who just likes to fix things, or you're, you know, designing new AI, or, you know, we hope that you kind of gain something from this panel and that you kind of take this forward in the future. I was looking at the comments and people are going to watch Star Wars this weekend. So hopefully we had an influence on you guys. All right. Ani, do you have any closing words?
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to thank everyone again. Thank you, Katie and CJ, for, you know, making sure everything runs. Thank you, Ellen, for organizing a really fun talk. I had high hopes and this exceeded them. Also, I just wanted to remind those of you who are left in attendance, we are continuing our seminars in 2 weeks. We're still working on one, but in 3 weeks, we have a special one organized by Sam Coogan on applying for faculty positions because it's faculty application season. And so, especially for you senior grad students and postdocs, hopefully that's very valuable to you. And we look forward to seeing you again in the next few weeks. So thank you again. Everybody stay safe and have a great day.
Live long and prosper.
Yeah.